all stood up. I'm going to ask you to please be seated. Now, normally we sit for the prelude and we just listen as we prepare ourselves. But Irene Turney, who's back there, and yes, I'm going to call you out, Irene. Irene, you command a room because I'm going to tell you, you stood up and everybody else started standing up too. So thank you. And welcome and happy Easter, everybody. We are so glad that you're here. Now, I thought there might be a couple of kids here today. I was told that there might be. And I'm like, what represents resurrection any more than bubbles? So the fact that there are no children here, I happen to know there are a couple of big kids here. Irene, I'm picking on you today. Do you like blowing them? Okay. There you go. No, that wasn't very good. Let's see it again. Right on me. All right. So there you go. When you tell your friends that you went to church. So when you tell them that you went to church today, you can say, yeah, and we blew bubbles. So if anybody wants to do it afterwards, you can. Is it working now? We're good now. Yeah. We're going to figure it out. Unfortunately, to get a new good mic is a big expense, so we're trying to figure why this isn't working, and hopefully we don't have to replace it, but if we do, then we will do what we have to do. Does it sound good now? Eleanor gives me the okay, so it's okay now. She's going to, if it's not, I'm looking at you, and you're going to do this, and then I'm going to know that it's not working. Okay. So today, we are called to be an Easter people. And so we are called to new life and reconciliation with God, with each other, and with all of creation. As an act of resurrection and reconciliation, we acknowledge that we are blessed to live on this land, a sacred land, a land cared for, nurtured, and respected by those who were here before and settled here. We name that we worship on the traditional territory of the Anishinaabewake and the Mississauga. We, as settlers, have not honored the promises we made, and so we have a duty and an obligation to name those wrongs and to act to reconcile the wrongs that have been done. May we work in reconciliation with the Indigenous people of this land. We ask for God's strength and guidance as we commit ourselves to building right and faith-filled relations. Our opening hymn is Welcome, Happy Morning, and this time I'll invite you to stand.
Today is day.
seated. I'll invite you now. Oh, no, I won't invite you now. First, I'm going to have the candle lit, and Aiden is going to do that for me today.
Today we light this candle to represent a new life and new beginning, where we live in hope, hope for a new world that lives the kingdom of God here and now, hope in a Christ that lives, hope in a life everlasting. Alleluia.
We light this candle as a symbol of hope in the risen Christ. Alleluia. Thank you. And now I invite you to our responsive call to worship. Your responses are in bold on the screen and in your bulletin. Come, new day has dawned.
First day of a new creation.
Look up and see what God has done.
The stone will roll away once for all.
Christ is going ahead of you.
And we must share.
I'll ask you to remain seated for our reflection time. We are going to sing the refrain and verse 1 to start. And then at the end, we will sing verse 3 and the refrain. Day to a new world, O God, for you have changed everything. Christ is alive. We thank you for new light that shines and for messengers that explain when we can barely believe our eyes. We take a deep breath, a pause to take it all in. We hardly know how to be grateful for the impossible thing you have done. We praise you for your power that rolled back the stone and for your grace that invites us all, even when we have failed to live up to your vision. You are already a step ahead, going before us into the world and calling us to join you there. We pray you would give us eager hearts and open eyes to look past our fear of the unknown, that in Christ's resurrection we too may be raised into the light of new life in your kingdom. With mourning turning to dancing and joy overcoming despair, we offer our praise, for Christ is risen, he is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Alleluia.
Song, joy comes with the dawn.
Now, just before we have our scripture reading, somebody missed this earlier, so I got to do it again. Just because. All right. Here we go. Just for you. Just for you, this hello. You look beautiful. There you go. You ready? Let's see this. What's that? She's like, ooh, I don't know if I like those. And you know what? I'll give some to mommy later, and maybe you can do them later. There. There we go. There you go. All right. There you go. And I'll invite Court come up now and do our reading. Thanks, Courtney.
Our reading today is from Mark chapter 16, verses 1 to 8. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, brought spices so they might go and anoint him. And very early on, the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Autumn. That was beautiful. Loving Christ, you are here. May you be in these words. May you be in our thoughts. May you be in our hearts. Amen. For the past several weeks, we've been following Jesus through the Gospel of Mark. And today we come to the conclusion, well, sort of. Most Bible versions include an additional ending that we did not read today because scholars now believe that the text written after verse 8 was not part of the original manuscript of Mark. It is believed that this alternative ending was added much later to try and tie up some loose ends. What is different about Mark's gospel from the other gospels is that it ends without any sort of resurrection encounter. Jesus has been crucified, he has been buried, and when the women come to anoint him 2 days later, his body is gone. Instead of the dead body that the two Marys and Salome expect to find, they find a young man, an angel dressed in a white robe who tells them that Jesus has been raised. This vision in white instructs them to tell the disciples that Jesus would meet them in Galilee. And that's the end. It's a kind of a cliffhanger. The tomb is open, the body is missing, some stranger is in Jesus' place, and according to him, Jesus has been raised from the dead, and we will meet his friends later. The end. No resurrection stories, not one encounter story, no sudden appearances by Jesus in locked rooms, not one story in the original Gospel of Mark that offers any sort of proof that Jesus has been risen. Mark's gospel tells us that the women were alarmed, that they fled in terror and amazement, and that they were afraid. And I guess they were, because who wouldn't be terrified? But if I was one of these three women, once I came to my senses, I would have asked a lot of questions. The first one being, if Jesus isn't here, then where is he? It's not at all surprising that some early scribes added an ending to Mark's gospel that helped to answer some questions. It is also not surprising that the other gospel stories of Matthew, Luke, and John offer additional and differing details, because these were all written as a way to answer the questions of the members of the early Christian churches. Different groups of people found in a variety of communities at different times. The account we read today in Mark was the first gospel written around 70 AD, almost 40 years after the crucifixion of Jesus. Matthew was written 10 to 20 years after that, and John was written around 90 AD, and Luke is thought to have been written anywhere between 80 and 120. Now imagine that you were a member of an early Christian community, someone without the benefit of a Bible or a New Testament scripture or a global church. You've heard stories about Jesus, about how he walked the earth, about how he promised to usher in a new kingdom of God. You were told that he came to reconcile the world and to make life better. You have heard the story of his brutal crucifixion and how 2 days later his tomb was found empty when some women came to anoint his body. And then the story abruptly ends as it did in Mark. Wouldn't you have questions? I know I would. Imagine you are living in a world full of turmoil where people are dying around you from conflict, where your main place of worship, the Temple of Jerusalem, has been destroyed. And on top of that, you are now part of a new Jewish group, a group of people who understand Jesus to be the Messiah that your people have long awaited for. Imagine that you have been persecuted by your own people and by the Romans. If you were living in such a world of turmoil and uncertainty, there is the one thing you would need more than any other. Hope. You would need hope that Jesus was who you believed him to be. Hope that your suffering wasn't in vain. Hope that there was more to this life than the struggle that you have had to endure. hope that death is not the end. Hope is what the women who encountered the empty tomb wanted. It is what the members of the early church, Christian church, needed from the post-resurrection stories of encountering a risen Jesus. And I believe that it is probably what most people are looking for today. Hope. But I also think that most people come with as many questions today, perhaps even more than 2,000 years ago. Questions like, what am I supposed to believe? Was the body of Jesus really resurrected? If it wasn't, then what happened to the body? Am I a heretic if I don't believe what I was taught as a child by my parents or my Sunday school teachers or my minister? Am I naive if I do? Which, if any, of the gospel stories are true? Or are they simply there to teach us? And if I don't believe in a physical resurrection, what does that say about Jesus and life after death? And is it okay to believe in a spiritual resurrection? If you have questions and doubts this Easter, you are in good company. You are in the company of the women at the tomb and the disciples left to carry on the work of Jesus. You are in the company of the members of the early church and the modern church. And quite frankly, you are also in my company. Because I honestly don't know for sure what happened to the body of Jesus. The traditional understanding is that his physical body was raised. Some, as it says in the Gospel of Luke, believe that this body was stolen. There have been churches where people have claimed that they even have the corpse of Jesus. Some theologians, such as John Dominic Crossan and Marcus Borg, believe that the tomb and the resurrection story are allegories. The more I learn about the Bible and its history and what the historical life of Jesus was like, the more I'm convinced that the whereabouts of Jesus' human body isn't important. Because in spite of any questions I might have, I am more sure than ever that whatever happened that Easter morning, Christ lived. Christ, who lived through Jesus, continues to live on today. For me, the words, "He is risen," imply the release of the Christ, God's love into the world. If we understand the Christ as something that has existed in all eternity, as ecumenical teacher Richard Rohr teaches, then love can be found in and through all things. And resurrection is a mystery and a miracle that we can experience each and every day. Perhaps the story of Mark concluding with an empty tomb is enough, because the resurrection is something that we need to experience for ourselves and not something we can truly learn through the story of others. For us to really have hope, we need to live in it and know it. Jesus was crucified, but he lives on because love cannot be defeated by death. Love is eternal. When we are open to embracing that in all that is around us, that is when we experience the resurrection. Jesus is risen in the Christ, and that love of God remains for us. I know resurrection because I have experienced it. I've experienced it through the birth of my children, through the death of those I've journeyed with, through the Spirit that speaks in my heart, through a song, through others, and through this world. The song we heard Autumn sing today is a love song to someone who needs to know that a loved one who has died is still with them. It is for someone who needs hope that there is more. Today, those words could just as easily be a love song from the Christ to us. Christ says, I'm there. Anytime you laugh, anytime you cry, when you're on the grass lying on the ground, anytime you wash your hands, I'm out there in the baseball field, I'm out there in the books that you read, I am there each morning, I am there each fall, I am there in the music, I am there in the sky. Anytime you pray, anytime you fight, and anytime you gained a pound, anytime it's day, anytime it's night, I'm out there in the maple trees, in a summer breeze, I'm there on a perfect evening. I'm out there when you celebrate, I'm out there each morning, I'm there in the flowers, I'm there in the snow. Anytime you sing, I am there. Where is Jesus? Ask the women. The tomb is empty, the body of Jesus is gone, but the Spirit of Christ remains. I am where you are, the Christ calls out. I am there. Amen.
This is a song I wrote. I played it here a couple times before. Resurrection Hallelujah, my Easter song. Sing along if you can, if you can get it. Risen, we're forgiven. Hallelujah, hallelujah. By the heavens, resurrection. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Died for mankind. Your sins and mine, hallelujah, hallelujah. Selfless and true, always loved you, hallelujah. Ascended, hallelujah, hallelujah, leaving behind doubt for clear minds, hallelujah, hallelujah, faith in God's work ever after, hallelujah, hallelujah. Spirits risen, new beginning, hallelujah, hallelujah. Eternal living, kingdom of heaven, hallelujah. Praising, we're rejoicing, hallelujah, hallelujah. boast in your God, joyous praise song, hallelujah, hallelujah. Sing praise for God, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Thanks, Mike. That was great. I'm now going to invite Autumn up to say a few words on behalf of the Affirm Social Justice Committee. Put on a different hat now. There you go. Yeah.
Different hat. Hello, everyone. My name again is Autumn Smith, and my pronouns are she, her. And I am the chair of the Social Justice and Affirming Committee here at Trinity United Church in Gravenhurst. Today, as we celebrate Easter, we also recognize that it is International Transgender Day of Visibility, also called Transgender Day of Visibility. This is an annual event that occurs on March 31st, and it is dedicated to celebrating transgender people and raising awareness of discrimination faced by transgender people worldwide, as well as a celebration of their contributions to society. It is also a day to take action to promote the rights and fight the discrimination against the transgender, non-binary, and two-spirit communities and people of other genders. There are many ways that we can uplift people in our trans communities. One of the most basic and crucial ways is to respect and honor individuals' preferred pronouns. Misgendering refers to the experience of being labeled by others as a gender than one that a person identifies with. The essential thing to do after learning someone's pronouns is remembering them to use those pronouns when referring to that person. Now, we are human. If you accidentally use the wrong pronoun when identifying someone, please correct yourself in front of that person. Don't make a big deal about it. Move on and begin using the right pronoun. We know everyone makes mistakes. And making visible your work to respect and use someone's proper pronouns after a mistake is an important moment to take. The onus is on us to exercise empathy and awareness with a full understanding that the trans community faces discrimination and hate every single day. Pronouns are just the beginning, a way of seeing a person the way that they wish to be seen and valued. As we celebrate today in the resurrection, we are reminded that God moves through all of us without judgment. Jesus was the personification of inclusion and love. We are grateful to the transgender people of our community and the contributions that they have made and continue to make every single day. So, together, collectively, let's do all that we can to ensure that everyone feels respected and honored for who they are and how they identify.
Thanks, Autumn. It is now time for our offering. Have the offering plate as you come into the sanctuary. We stop passing it around through the pandemic, but of course we still rely on your contributions to keep things going. I'm going to ask Nancy now to bring up the plate, and we will have a blessing on that offering. Thank you. On this Easter Sunday, may we remember your words to us, O God. May we hear your revelations declared. May we share in word and action all that we have come to hold dear and true. May we embrace and be transformed by stones rolled away and garments folded. And in responding hope and faith, let us offer our treasures, our talents, our time, our very selves to the work of God in our congregation, our community, and beyond. May we and our gifts serve justice, righteousness, and love each and every day. Amen. We'll now sing together, We Gather Here. Today is the day of resurrection. Any time that we break bread together, Christ is there. Now just remind you that your responses are in bold on the screen or in your bulletins. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give our thanks and praise.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Hallelujah, thanks and praise, ever-living God, worker of wonders, maker of miracles, author of all life, and giver of life eternal. Out of chaos and fear, you bring beauty and hope. Out of despair and death, you create courage and new life. And so, with the risen Christ who makes all things new by the power of his resurrection, we join in the song of a new day to sing your praise. And I'll invite you to say this together with me. Holy, 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 holy God of power and light, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of God. Hosanna in the highest. As we gather at this table, we remember that on the night before he died, Jesus had supper with his friends. While they were eating, he took a loaf of bread, and after he blessed it, he broke it. And he gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them and said, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for many. Each time you break bread and drink from this cup, remember me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Send, O God, your Holy Spirit upon us and what we do here, that we and these gifts touched by your Spirit may be signs of life and love to one another and the world. Amen. Let us pray. Early in the morning, the tomb is open and you are already on the way, risen Christ. We come looking for you only to find you have gone ahead and called us to follow. We praise you for good news that cannot be contained even by our fears or failures. On this day of resurrection, we pray for a world desperate for a glimpse of your new life, for those surrounded by violence, death, and destruction, for those grieving and who cannot be consoled, for those whose world has been turned upside down by the greed, power-mongering, or vengeance of others, for those who suffer as seas rise and deserts expand and weather patterns become unpredictable, for those who have been overlooked and ignored yet expected to perform essential work, for those who are bound by fear of not being good enough. Roll back the stone, O God, once and for all, for you are the one who can overcome all barriers. Set your resurrection power loose in the world, in our lives, and in our community, bringing justice and peace, comfort and joy, love stronger than death. Surprise us with your impossible grace, breaking down what we thought we knew and building up a new community of hope, always on the move towards your kingdom. We ask in the name of the one who has been raised and who raises us to new life with him, Jesus the Christ. Amen. I invite you now to pray with me the words that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So I'm going to invite Eileen and Leah and Judy to come forward, and I'm just going to give you a little bit of instruction of how we do communion here. So people who are on this side of the sanctuary will come forward. I will offer you bread. We have gluten-free here. If you need gluten-free, I will hand you the cup and I'll allow you to pick it. I've been touching bread and I don't want to touch the crackers, so but we do have gluten-free crackers there. So you'll come forward, I will offer you the bread, and then Judy, if you come to this side, will give you a cup of wine. I ask that you consume it here, and then as you walk over there, you can put your cup in the little basket, and if you want, there's an Easter egg beside the basket. So you can have one of those too, because this is a meal that we share with one another, so we got to have some Easter chocolate at Easter. And then you go back to your seat. So same with this side. I'll invite you to come here. I'll invite you to receive the bread from Eileen. And then Leah will give you the cup. And again, you can take your little cup over there after you've consumed your juice. It is juice, by the way, not wine. You consume the juice and pick yourself up a chocolate if you want. If you need me to come to you in your seat, I can do that as well. I'll do that at the end. And if I have missed you, if I haven't noticed you, just put your hand up or call to me and yell at me. I don't know. I'll come, I promise. Please just stay there and I can come to you. We'll invite the choir to come first to receive communion, and then I'll just ask you to come forward. Thank you. Gracious God, may your gifts of love transform and enliven us that we may live lives of thanksgiving. May your presence among us provoke such longing for your realm that we will never be satisfied until the whole earth knows your justice, your peace, and your love. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right, it is time for our announcements. And to be honest, I didn't write any down, but so I have to look at my bulletin. I will say that the office will be closed tomorrow, so there won't be prayer and meditation. And there will not be any prayer and meditation next Monday, as I'm on a study week starting next Monday. I think that's all you need to know right now. Everything else is in the bulletin. I want to say thank you for coming out today. What a beautiful Easter Sunday day. If you're visiting, we're so glad that you came out. If you're somebody I've known for a long time, I'm just as happy you're here. Thank you, and I'm going to see where we are now. Oh, we are going to do the traditional. Jesus Christ is risen today, so please stand if you're able.
Jesus Christ is risen today. Alleluia. Our triumphant holy day. Alleluia. Who did once upon the cross. Alleluia. Suffered to
watching from home, even you people in Portugal and wherever else you are right now, because I know I heard from some of you this morning, that we are the church. And wherever you are, may you feel God's love to the left of you and the right of you, in front of you and behind you, above you and below you, within you and within everyone you meet, now and always. I'm going to invite some people to come and sing with us. Autumn, do you want to join us? Mike, would you like to join us? No. No, I guess I've been told. All right, come on. There's a few people who like to come and join as we sing Go Now in Peace. And so we're happy to have you here. Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm not going to stand in front of you, Elaine. There you go. Okay. There you go. Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
We're going to listen to the postlude, and then there is coffee and lots of goodies downstairs, so if you're able to join us, that would be wonderful. I think the words are on the screen as well.
Including all in circles of our heart.
Thank you.